Good evening. My name is Rich Grubbins, theology teacher and coordinator of theology outreach and conferences at Archbishop McCarthy High School. Welcome to the second installment of McCarthy High School's second annual Spring Speaker Series. Last year, we brought in prominent Catholic scholars, authors, and speakers to our community to enlighten us on a wide variety of topics to help us grow in knowledge and love of the faith. We happily continue that tradition again this year, and now in person. This evening's presenter is Dr. Roger Nutt. His presentation is entitled, To Die is Gain, Reflections on Christian Dying and Anointing of the Sick. This talk will develop themes from Dr. Nutt's new book, To Die is Gain, a theological reintroduction to the sacrament of anointing of the sick for clergy, laity, caregivers, and everyone else. The purpose of this book is to help all Catholics, indeed everyone, to better appreciate the profundity of the gift of the sacrament of anointing of the sick as a fundamental component of the Christian response to the crisis of suffering and death. Dr. Nutt hopes that by reflecting on the theology and spirituality contained in the Church's teaching on the sacrament of the sick, that we may all rethink death and the meaning of our lives in light of faith in Christ's own death and resurrection. Roger W. Nutt, STD, is provost of Ave Maria University. He holds graduate degrees from the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas Angelicum, Rome, and Franciscan University at Steubenville in Ohio. He joined the university in 2006 as a member of the theology department, where he continues to serve as associate professor. He teaches the core curriculum course, Theology 205, Sacred Doctrine, and upper-level undergraduate and graduate courses on sacraments and Christology. He co-directs the Aquinas Center for Theological Renewal with Dr. Michael Dauphine and Dr. Stephen Long, and is a member of the Academy of Catholic Theology. His research focuses on Christology and sacramental theology, and especially the theology of St. Thomas Aquinas. He is the author of three books, he has translated a number of works, and his articles and book chapters have appeared in many publications. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions or meet with our presenter personally at the end of the talk. And now please welcome Dr. Roger Nutt.
I'm honored to be here at Archbishop McCarthy High School. Ave Maria University has a close bond with Archbishop McCarthy. A number of our alumni teach here. I'm honored to stand before one of my own former students, Dr. John O'Neill, tonight to present to you. Thank you, especially Mr. Grebich, for the invitation. I want to say a brief word before I share some of my prepared comments. Some people think that it's odd that I wrote a book on dying and how to die well in light of the Christian faith, and I admit that there's nothing that takes the oxygen out of the room like someone who wants to speak about death, but I had the privilege of teaching sacramental theology year after year after year, and when we think about the sacraments, we obviously gravitate to baptism because it's the most necessary, and of course the Eucharist because it's the greatest. And anointing of the sick is probably the sacrament that's treated the least in literature on the sacraments. And as I developed my own notes and my own thinking about anointing of the sick and teaching the material, I came away with the conviction that the theology of the sacrament of the anointing of the sick is incredibly underappreciated and a profound gift to the church and to the life of faith. And that I thought that it was worth trying to unpack the significance and profundity of the sacrament. I started writing the book before the pandemic, but I think the topic has become even more relevant after and during the pandemic, because there's no question that death is something that is a foreboding mystery that we all are confronted by, and hopefully through the thoughts that I share, we'll be able to think about our journey through this life and the reality of death with some greater resources from the wisdom of the Church. So, introduction, Mr. Grebich, when you get back, if you could flip to the first slide. I've got some introductory comments and then three interrelated sections. In inspired autobiographical words offered to the Christian community at Philippi, in light of the truth of Christ's resurrection, St. Paul declares, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Death and gain have not been words frequently associated with each other for quite some time. At least in Western societies today, it has become as uncouth to speak about death as religion and politics. In our economically comfortable and morally indifferent post-Christian societies, Joseph Ratzinger observes that death is placed under a taboo. It is unseemly. So far as possible, it must be hidden away, the thought of it repressed in waking consciousness. A certain superficial view of scientific progress has promised to solve all of humanity's problems. Next slide. By becoming a byproduct, Joseph Ratzinger observes, death is supposed to vanish as a question mark about the nature of being human, a more than technological inquiry. The issue of euthanasia is becoming increasingly important because people wish to avoid death as something which happens to me and replace it with a technical cessation of function which I do not need to carry out myself. End quote. Medical doctor L.S. Dugdale pinpoints a shift away from the Christian art of dying, or ars moriendi, attitude toward life and death, to the postmodern flight from death. Next slide. Quote, whereas the ars moriendi, that is the traditional Christian attitude that life, actually in life, we should cultivate an art of dying or dying well, taught that a person cultivated good life habits with a view to dying well, the early 20th century came to focus solely on living well, death and dying be damned. End quote. The cultural drift away from the foundations of faith, coupled with the great advances in medical science, have altered people's understanding, Christians included, of healing, spiritual, sacramental, or otherwise. The Christian doctrine of healing, which is realized most fully in eternal beatitude and bodily resurrection, is not to be conflated with the scientific medicinal understanding of healing. This narrow view of healing as a cure for an ailment has grave conscious consequences in the life of the church when the sacrament of anointing of the sick is recast in these terms. Following the work of Father Christopher Saliga, Father Paul Keller points out that when explaining the purpose of holy anointing to the faithful, we must distinguish between healing in the theological sense of being saved by God and cure in the medical sense. Presenting Saliga's insights, next slide, Father Keller explains, quote, he's talking about another author, writes about the misunderstanding regarding the anointing of the sick. When it is thought to be the only alternative left, a sacramental last-ditch effort or placebo-type palliative intervention. A cure, he says, refers to a patient's scientifically measurable positive response to a therapeutic intervention or combination of such interventions. Healing, within the Catholic sphere, however, is something that transcends temporality. It may or may not involve cure, even when cure is fairly holistically defined. This is the case because healing is understood relative to the ultimate reason for which we exist, the face-to-face beatific union with God for all eternity. End quote. Modern medicine can cure many significant bodily ailments, and we should be grateful for these advances. But God's healing brings salvation, eternal happiness, and bodily resurrection. The cure mentality towards sacramental healing forgets that Christ did not redeem us from having to die. Rather, he redeemed us from the eternal loss that results from sin. The sacrament of anointing of the sick reveals many aspects of the faith of the church and the true nature of the full salvific healing accomplished by Christ. It does so by clarifying the effects of the fall, the nature of sin, and the role of the sacraments and sacramental healing in Christ's redemptive plan. We live at a time in which the doctrinal message of the sacrament of the sick and the graces that it confers are needed more than ever. In the remaining portions of this lecture, I sketch in three overlapping sections how the nature of sin and its effects, especially the so-called remnants of sin, and the primary effects that the church ascribes to holy anointing correspond to the spiritual needs that every being, human being has during the dying process. When understood within its proper division of labor in the Christian life, anointing of the sick can be fully appreciated as a gift to be cherished, not as a technological cure for the sake of clinging to this life, but for the sake of dying in union with God, so as to be with Him for eternity. Next slide. Part one, the lasting effect, or what is sometimes called the remnants of sin. As a result of the fall from grace, by our first parents, the tendency to sin is especially strong in relation to those things that bring bodily comfort and pleasure. St. Paul personifies and personalizes this tendency to sin within each human being in a powerful description of his own struggles. Famously, this is from Romans 7. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, and making me captive to the law of sin, which dwells in my members. This struggle is something that every human being, including followers of Christ, experience within themselves. It is easy to think of each particular sin as a transient action that has no abiding impact on the moral, spiritual, or bodily life of those who commit them. However, as St. Paul reminds the Romans, while God's free gift of grace leads to eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord, the life of sin also pays out negative dividends. The wages of sin is death. Sin is thus not just an ailment of the soul, it also impacts bodily life. The gift of grace heals the soul and brings forgiveness, but the lasting impact of sin remains, leaving every person vulnerable to recurring inclinations to sinful behavior or weakness. In the early church, the doctrine of the deadly sins was developed to underscore that sinful actions can become vicious habits that remain within us. And just to provide a simple example, people who quit smoking still have bodily reactions left within them, sometimes even years after, to return to the habit of smoking. So we often view moral actions as things that just happen and then are gone, and we don't appreciate the positive or the negative impact that they can leave within even our very bodily life. This is especially true when we're vulnerable and weak, facing death. When we are especially weak during the dying process, the remains of sin within us more readily assault us. Anointing of the sick is Christ's spiritual antidote to the bodily remnants of sin that remain in each human being. If the remnants of sin in the body weigh down or tie the soul to earthly attachments, fears, or regrets, the soul can be impeded from surrendering to the will of God at the end of one's life. Articulating the relationship between the soul and the body in terms that help people understand the unity of the human person is challenging. Some Christian thinkers use the metaphor of the impact that weather has on a body of water. A windy, raucous climate disturbs the water. So too, the acts of the body can disturb the soul, and disordered movements of the soul can disturb the body. In our earthly journey, it is difficult to eradicate the reflections of unholy things and actions to which we have subjected the soul. These sinful reflections weigh upon us, attach us to the world, and leave us vulnerable, especially during the emotional, the physical and emotional pain and fatigue that burden those departing this life. Next slide. Part two, the remnants of sin and who is to receive holy anointing. A simple question or two will help us to appreciate how the remnants of sin within us relate to sacramental healing and the theology of anointing of the sick. Here's a question. If the fall was a fall from grace, a spiritual death leading to bodily corruption, and if the grace given in baptism cleanses original sin and personal sin from the soul, then why do the baptized struggle, suffer temptations, and die? In short, why is post-baptismal life shrouded often with the same challenges as pre-baptismal life? The differences between the condition in which Adam and Eve received grace prior to the fall and the condition in which their descendants received the grace of the new law provides an answer to this difficulty. After the fall, when anyone receives the graces of baptism and the other sacraments, they are receiving grace into human natures that have been touched by sin and its consequent disorders. In this fallen world in need of redemption, the healing received from receiving the sacraments is progressive and ongoing. It is not fully realized until the resurrection of the body and the restoration of all things under Christ. The break of a bone can heal, and the function of a wounded area can return, but the remnants and vulnerabilities of the old injury remain. Next slide. This is a citation from the Catechism. Certain temporal consequences, it's developing this point, of sin remain in the baptized, the Catechism explains, such as suffering, illness, death, and such frailties inherent in life as meekness of character, and so on, as well as an inclination to sin that the tradition calls concupiscence, or metaphorically, the tinder for sin. Since concupiscence is left for us to wrestle with, it cannot harm those who do not consent, but manfully resist it by the grace of Jesus Christ. End quote. Christ redeemed us from the eternal loss caused by sin by dying on the cross. But we must complete the temporal journey of this life in union with him in order to enjoy the fruits of his risen life in the next life. Before treating the effects of anointing of the sick, it is important to clarify for whom Christ instituted this sacrament, a point about which there has been some confusion since the Second Vatican Council. Christ instituted each sacrament of the Church for a specific purpose. Like each of the sacraments, there are necessary conditions for the reception of anointing of the sick. This sacrament in particular has been the subject to abuse in regards to its administration. And this abuse has contributed to a false perception of the healing that Christ intends to accomplish in each recipient of the sacrament. Turns it more into a medicinal cure. For example, I was once at a parish that celebrated anointing of the sick on a fixed Sunday each month after a Sunday Mass. At the end of the Mass, the priest announced that this was the Sunday for the celebration of anointing of the sick. He invited anyone who is not feeling quite right to stay after Mass and receive the sacrament. This type of administration of the sacrament, decoupled from dying or grave illness, however, is not only theologically and liturgically problematic, it is also incredibly misleading and confusing for the faithful. The sacrament is to be given to the faithful at a time when the remnants of sin are especially difficult to overcome. The sacrament of anointing of the sick is not intended for those who are ill in the sense of being a bit off, having a cold or a flu, and it is certainly not intended for those who are feeling off emotionally. As Father Romanus Cesario points out, Christ's intention in instituting anointing of the sick was not as the appropriate Catholic setting to offer a Christian-tinged form of psychological grief counseling. Abuse in the administration of anointing of the sick is often justified in the name of the teaching of the Second Vatican Council, on the false premise that the council detached the dispensation of the sacrament from serious illness and end-of-life situations. Prior to the council, of course, anointing of the sick was spoken of as extreme unction. It is extreme, extremos, because it is the last anointing received by a Christian. Vatican II does caution against the practice of waiting to administer the sacrament until the recipient's very last moments. As a result, the Council speaks of anointing of the sick instead of extreme unction. However, the nuanced language and administration of the sacrament earlier in the dying process in no way decouples the sacrament from the sinful vulnerabilities that arise when facing grave illness. Next slide, please. So this is the teaching of the Council from Sacrosanctum Concilium on the move from administering the sacraments in the very last moments of one's life to a little earlier in the dying process. Final anointing, the Council teaches, which can also and better be called anointing of the sick, is not a sacrament exclusively for those who are involved in the final crisis of life and death. There can therefore be no doubt that the point when a Christian begins to be in danger of death, either through illness or old age, is already a suitable time to receive it. End quote. The perception that Vatican II taught that the sacrament is not for those who are facing death due to sickness or old age is simply an urban legend that needs correction in light of the clear teaching and practice of the Church. The Church now offers the sacrament to the sick earlier in the dying process so that the recipients may benefit from its graces throughout their ordeal. This adjustment in the timing of the administration of the sacrament was not intended to modify the basic tenet of faith that Christ instituted the sacrament for those who are gravely ill. Yeah. So the Church does teach that the sacrament need not be administered merely at the point of death. However, the Church also offers two conditions that the eligible recipient must meet. First, they must have at least begun to be in danger of death. And second, the danger of death must be due to sickness or old age. The point here should not be lost. Christians face many challenges and crises throughout their lives. Christ instituted this sacrament precisely for the sake of aiding dying Christians in this last crisis. The Church offers other resources to the faithful to aid them in other crises. The Council of Trent, in fact, next slide please, recognizes the vulnerabilities that can accompany facing death as the reason why the Lord instituted this sacrament. Quote, "For though our adversary seeks and seizes opportunities through the whole of life of finding ways to devour our souls, yet there is no time at which he draws more strongly on every shred of skill to destroy us utterly and to deprive us, if he can, of our confidence in the divine mercy than when he sees that our departure from life is at hand." The fact that some temporal consequences of sin remain a part of the life of each of the follower of Christ, even after baptism, helps explain why Christ instituted two sacraments ordered to post-baptismal healing. The sacraments of penance and anointing of the sick form a family of sacraments associated with healing in the Christian life. Sin wounds the bonds of union between the soul and God and the bonds of charity that join believers to each other in Christ's body. The grace of the sacrament heals and restores those lost bonds of unity between the sinner and God and the sinner and the members of Christ's body. As a result, the healing that is received in the sacrament of penance restores and revivifies the bonds of grace, especially charity, between God and neighbor that are wounded by our sins. Why then is there need for another sacrament of healing besides penance? Being forgiven by God through the graces of the sacrament of penance does not eliminate the remnants of sin in the life of the believer. As already noted, the struggle against sin and the tendency to sin remain after the forgiveness of baptism and subsequently after penance. As an aside, I use the example with my students. If a child throws a ball through a window and walks over to apologize to the homeowner, and the homeowner forgives the child, and the child goes home forgiven, the owner says, "Don't worry about it, I understand, I was a child once too," the window is still broken. So forgiveness can pardon the mark or stain that we associate with the fault. The one who's offended can say it's okay, but the disorder caused by the fault still abides, and in the case of the body-soul relationship, sometimes sins that we have forgiven of still linger in the body, and we easily fall back or regress into those patterns of behavior. The theological distinction between the stain of sin and the corresponding abiding condition present in the sinner is important for understanding the distinction between penance and anointing of the sick. The sacrament of penance remits both mortal and venial sin. However, as I just mentioned, being forgiven of sins in baptism or penance cleanses the soul from the mark or stain, but does not undo the remaining condition or weakness caused by the fault. Because of the relationship between soul and body, these remnants afflict our bodily existence. Simply because we have obtained forgiveness for our sins in baptism or later in penance and other sacraments does not mean that the consequences of those sins will not continue to plague us in the body throughout our temporal journey. Following the teaching of Thomas Aquinas, who uses the analogy of the diverse medicines that are needed in relation to various conditions of bodily health, next slide, please. Father Romanus Cesario observes, "One may be without illness, but still not in good shape. Penance is ordered to spiritual health, and as much as this sacrament brings healing from the illness of sin, whereas holy anointing restores robustness to a fatigued spiritual life. Its medicinal effects attend to the various remains of sin that weaken or limit a healthy but not vigorous spiritual life." End quote. Quitting a vice and receiving forgiveness for it does not mean that the effects of that vice will not linger and cause future vulnerabilities and temptations. The future effects of sinful actions are often underappreciated. The short-term pleasures gained by sins in the present often scourge people disproportionately in the future. In his redemptive plan, God does not stop simply with forgiveness while leaving the disorders caused by sin unaddressed. Next slide. Part 3, sacramental grace and the graces of anointing of the sick. What makes the sacrament of anointing of the sick such a profound gift to the church is that the graces it confers help us to overcome the vulnerabilities corresponding to the remnants of sin, so that dying can be accepted in a spiritually fruitful manner and made into an offering to God. This sacrament is ordered precisely to aiding Christians in overcoming the vulnerabilities and anxieties that they suffer as a result of bodily weakness and fatigue when they are dying. The sacraments are Christ's privileged way of sanctifying each Christian from the first healing given in baptism to the ultimate attainment of glory in heaven. In addition to the healing, sanctification, and elevation that are associated with the gift of grace and the infused virtues and gifts, each sacrament also provides graces that are necessary to supporting Christians in the various stages and moments of need. Next slide, please. Thomas Aquinas explains the purpose of the sacraments vis-a-vis the unique graces that they cause for the sake of assisting Christians in various vocations and circumstances. Quote, "Now the sacraments are ordained unto special effects which are necessary in the Christian life. Consequently, just as the virtues and gifts confer, in addition to grace commonly so called, a special perfection ordained to the powers of the soul proper action, so does sacramental grace confer over and above grace commonly so called, and in addition to the virtues and gifts, a certain divine assistance in obtaining the end of the sacrament." End quote. This important point is often misunderstood or hidden from non-Catholic Christians, especially those denominations that descend from the Reformation. The seven sacraments are not seven redundant instances of grace generically understood. Sometimes in the Reformed tradition, or especially the evangelical tradition, they think there's one grace. Are you saved or not saved? And that point fails to appreciate the whole myriad of graces that God intends to communicate to us at different stages and different vocations in life through the sacraments. The remnants of sin that remain can make the dying person more susceptible to doubt, anger, fear, loneliness, despair, envy, and other vices that are harder to resist in a condition of physical weakness, exhaustion, and emotional fatigue. As a result, the Catechism teaches, next slide, that the first grace of this sacrament is, quote, "a particular gift of the Holy Spirit, one of strengthening peace and courage to overcome the difficulties that go with the condition of serious illness or the frailty of old age. This grace is a gift of the Holy Spirit who renews trust and faith in God and strengthens against the temptations of the evil one, the temptation to discouragement and anguish in the face of death." End quote. It is important to note, contrary to the expectations of many, which are fueled by the modern aversion to death and the cure-based medicinal understanding of healing, and the unfortunate practice of bestowing this sacrament on those who are not in danger of death, that the first grace of anointing of the sick is not physical healing. The object of this sacrament is not the evasion of death. This is one of the reasons why it was previously administered in closer conjunction to the moment of the death of the recipient. The Catechism reminds that illness can lead to anguish, self-absorption, sometimes even despair and revolt against God. These negative effects of the remnants of past, these are the negative effects of the remnants of past sin. The Church explains the gift of the Holy Spirit given in the sacrament in terms of strengthening in the face of difficulties that accompany facing death. This grace of strengthening is ordered to assisting the recipient in trusting God and resisting temptations, such as discouragement and loneliness too, that can result from facing death in a weakened Anglican state. It is natural, on one hand, for Catholics to desire a miraculous healing for themselves or their loved ones. However, from the perspective of faith, we know that life with God in heaven is not only better than this life, it is our true and ultimate purpose. If a miraculous healing is granted by God through this sacrament, which is very rare but certainly possible, the miracle is not given to save the person who is healed from having to die at some point in the future. Even Lazarus, whom Jesus raised from the dead, had to suffer death a second time to join Jesus in heaven. Even if one is already in the state of grace, the grace of each of the sacraments brings the presence of God to the believer in a newer and fuller way. This sacrament thus mediates the close proximity that Christ has to the sick and the dying in a unique and richly merciful fashion. Those who are united to Christ can join their sufferings to His, thus giving their trial a spiritual dimension. While in a certain sense Christ has solidarity with all who suffer, anointing of the sick confers a special conformity in grace of the recipient of the sacrament to Christ. Next slide, please. By the grace of this sacrament, the Catechism teaches, the sick person receives the strength and gift of uniting himself more closely to Christ's passion. In a certain way, he is consecrated to bear fruit by configuration to the Savior's redemptive passion. Suffering, a consequence of original sin, acquires a new meaning. It becomes a participation in the saving work of Jesus. Because anointing of the sick joins those approaching death to Christ's passion through the particular effect of the sacrament, their suffering takes on an added dimension that makes it an instrument of Christ's redemptive work. When accepted under the light of Christian faith, the union with Christ caused by the sacrament of anointing of the sick makes the sick person's very weakness and proximity to death a source of prayer, spiritual offering, and service. Far from being pointless and without meaning, when joined to Christ sacramentally, the very acceptance of suffering and the act of dying itself can be offered to God as extensions of Christ's own redemptive work. In fact, there is a reciprocal relationship between the sick person's reliance on the church for the graces of the sacrament and the church's reliance on the sick person for her growth in holiness. Next slide, please. The sick who receive this sacrament, the Catechism teaches, by freely uniting themselves to the passion and death of Christ, contribute to the good of the people of God. By celebrating this sacrament, the Church and the communion of saints intercedes for the benefit of the sick person, and he, for his part, through the grace of the sacrament, contributes to the sanctification of the Church and to the good of all men for whom the Church suffers and offers herself through Christ to God the Father. End quote. Even though the person who is approaching death because of sickness or old age is, from a physical standpoint, quite powerless, it is most certainly not the case that they have nothing to offer the Church or God. In the same way, therefore, that we speak of baptismal, eucharistic, or priestly spirituality, anointing of the sick opens the way for a spirituality of suffering and dying. Suffering and weakness might be useless to those who worship brute force and physical productivity, but as the life of Christ teaches, the condition of weakness and vulnerability is God's chosen vessel for manifesting his true power. The supernatural life that is begun with the graces of baptism and augmented with the other sacraments is brought to completion with this last sacrament. Next slide, please. Again, from the Catechism, the anointing of the sick completes our conformity to the death and resurrection of Christ, just as baptism began it. It completes the holy anointings that mark the whole Christian life. the life of baptism which sealed the new life in us, and that of confirmation which strengthened us for the combat of this life. This last anointing fortifies the end of our earthly life like a solid rampart for the final struggles before entering the Father's house. End quote. The manifold graces of anointing of the sick are intended by Christ to bring the whole life of grace to completion and eternal rest. The connection between anointing of the sick and our departure from this life to the next is especially fortified when it can be joined with the reception of the Eucharist. In conjunction with receiving the final anointings of our earthly journey, which especially fortifies the soul and joins up the recipient to Christ, the reception of Holy Communion is made uniquely fruitful. Next slide. In addition to the anointing of the sick, the Catechism explains, the Church offers those who are about to leave this life the Eucharist as viaticum. Communion in the body and blood of Christ, received at the passing over, at the moment of passing over to the Father, has a particular significance and importance. It is the seed of eternal life and the power of the resurrection, according to the words of Christ. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. The sacrament of Christ, once dead and now risen, the Eucharist is here, the sacrament passing over from death to life, from this world to the Father. When supported by the full richness of the sacramental life, those who face death are surrounded by the presence of Christ, who is there for them through the ministry of the Church, by the mediation of the three sacraments of penance, if it's possible to be received, along with anointing of the sick and viaticum. Far from being abandoned or alone at this time of weakness, the sick person is supported in his deepest spiritual needs by anointing of the sick and the other sacraments that he is able to receive. Conclusion. Next slide. In a sobering and realistic assessment of the arduous nature of the journey of each individual Christian life and the unfolding of human history, Vatican II's Pastoral Constitution on the Church in the Modern World, Gaudium et Spes, teaches, the whole of man's history has been the story of our combat with the powers of evil. Stretching, so our Lord tells us, from the very dawn of history until the last day. Finding himself in the midst of the battlefield, man has to struggle to do what is right, and it is at great cost to himself and aided by God's grace that he succeeds in achieving his own inner integrity. Unquote. Words and phrases like combat with the powers of evil, battlefield, struggle to do what is right at great cost to himself, are not easily embraced as essential components of the life to which Christ calls each of his followers, especially today. As alien as the description of human life in the language of combat and battle may be for Christians in the postmodern world, the tradition of faith has pressed this point with unambiguous consistency. In particular, the faith reminds believers that the battlefield on which the combat is played out extends to the very last moment of each of our lives. Just as the Christian people enter each week into the rest of the Lord's Day, so too is the death of every soul claimed by Christ a final Passover into the eternal Sabbath of the risen Lord. St. Paul reminds the Christians in Rome that none of us lives to himself and none of us dies to himself. If we live, we live with the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. To be guided by the reign of the risen Lord, the Christian faithful have to live and die for Christ. By turning to the graces of anointing of the sick, the faithful end their earthly lives by living the truth of Christ, which carries them on to the rest of eternal glory. In the words of St. Paul in Philippians 1:21, to die is gain. Thank you. Dr. O'Neill, you've asked me many, many questions over the years in class, so.
Yeah, so I thought it was excellent, thank you. And I myself have taken many sacraments, class two with you, and this sacrament is, of course, it's the last one you come to, so even if you apportion it a reasonable amount, it's at the end of the semester, and sometimes it gets skipped over for that reason, but yeah, it's definitely treated less. But I think there's a certain sense that you could say that if you don't understand the anointing of the sick, then you just don't understand what a sacrament is and what the sacraments are for, because all of the sacraments work by the power of Christ's passion, and they all give us a participation in Christ's Paschal mystery in one way or the other. But anointing the sick is kind of like the final cause. In a way, you could say the Eucharist is the final cause, but at least temporally, anointing the sick is kind of like the final cause of the whole sacramental life. And so clearly the Eucharist of itself is the greatest sacrament, but there's a sense in which you could say the greatest reception of the Eucharist is with the anointing of the sick. And that's your final conformity to Christ and his death. And that's what it's all for, is to prepare you for that moment. And if you don't understand that Christian life is preparing you for Christian death, you know, to be prepared for the next life, then you don't have your eyes set on the final goal, which is, you know, to rise with Christ, which requires our death. So, yeah, so but thank you. I thought that was, the whole thing was excellent. Thank you so much.
Any other questions?
I really appreciated, I've read the Catechism, but maybe I didn't focus enough on the particular quotes regarding the, I still tend to think of anointing as, can I get the anointing done, forgiveness of sins, preparing for the next life. And the idea that anointing will help one to more closely conform himself with Christ and his passion is a very powerful message. I'd love to see the church in general focus on that more, with the ramping up, I guess you might say, of euthanasia that is becoming more and more accepted. And I suspect, I haven't seen any statistics about that, but I suspect as the culture goes, so Catholics tend to go on other hot button issues like abortion, for example. I think if we were to emphasize this, in the church, emphasize the importance of us comporting ourselves to Christ in his passion, then this whole idea of death with dignity would take a different turn, I think. How do we think of Christ's death? Did he die a dignified death? Well, from a worldly perspective, definitely not. But to conform ourselves that way and to have the anointing as a way to help us through that the so-called dying process, I think is just something that would it really behooves the church to do that, to get us thinking right about end-of-life issues.
Yeah, I think, you know, we undersell how much God loves and reaches out to vulnerability and weakness, and really raises it up and bolsters it. And in the book, I did draw on that John Paul II's Salvifici Dolorosi on the saving meaning of suffering is a great place to look. But he also wrote a letter that got almost no attention around 99 or 2000 to the elderly, and he talks about the divine wisdom, the way that the divine wisdom unfolds in the aging process, Perhaps we have more wisdom to offer our children or our grandchildren, but we can also have to humbly accept that we have to rely on others more. And so the point about there being wisdom in the church that teaches us about aging and dying with dignity, I think, is a great one. And there's really some profundity there that is, in a way, lying dormant right now, that has to get cracked open and people really have to get exposed to it.
Dr. Nutt, I find it interesting that you, in the beginning, you mentioned you were at a parish that regularly offered the anointing on a monthly basis.
Yeah.
And I know parishes in this area that do that. Are there any diocesan restrictions that should be in place or that are in place in other dioceses?
There are. As a lay sacramental theologian, I try to tread lightly, you know, on the situation of abuses. I am familiar with a situation in a parish in which this kind of thing was happening. And when the bishop found out about it, the bishop asked, you know, that it not continue. So I think it's often a well-intentioned gesture. But the problem is, if you don't have that physical vulnerability that's associated with being in danger of death due to sickness or old age, the sacrament doesn't have what it needs to work on. And so people are receiving a sacrament thinking that some positive spiritual thing is happening to them when it's not happening. It's just as if we were to go to confession and not mention any sins. The priest can't grant absolution. So I do think, without any inquiry, I think priests should be always err on the side of generosity in these issues. So, you know, I recently had shoulder surgery and had to have general anesthesia. I did not receive the sacrament of anointing. But there has been broadly a pastoral rule that even if your condition doesn't threaten you, something like general anesthesia is serious, could be serious enough. But there should be some. That sacrament cannot be simply administered without saying, okay, what's the illness, or you know, what did the doctor tell you, or why are you requesting it? To, you know, simply invite people to indiscriminately receive it really does outstrip the whole theology and purpose of the sacrament. And sometimes I think what happens is that people need some other kind of help. Let's say they're struggling with addiction or they're struggling with depression, but we're drawn to spiritual things when we're in a dark place. And so we might receive this sacrament thinking that it's going to provide help for that ailment. It doesn't provide help for that ailment. We can actually be left in a worse or despairing place because of it.
Wow.
I like to think I'm pretty engaged in my faith over many years, but it's only recently, maybe the last couple years, that I heard of something. I don't remember the term, if it's apostolic anointing or something to that effect, which, if I understand correctly, takes away all temporal punishment due to sin.
Right, apostolic pardon.
Okay. Then I actually heard this, I think it was maybe on Catholic Answers or Father Mitch Peck or someone was talking about it. In any case, I think it was Father Mitch. But in any case, my question then is, why is this not more well known? And why wouldn't it always be used? Like, it seems to me like a no-brainer. If you have this in your arsenal,
right,
why not make every anointing? I mean, particularly that where it really does appear that it's end of life,
right,
to do that. I wouldn't compel you with that.
Sure. Well, in my research on the book, there is, like with all of the sacraments, you know, the church does promulgate rites, and in the case of the anointing of the sick, it's one of the more elastic sacraments. The essential rite is the same, obviously, the anointing with oil and the prayer that the priest says, but It can be done in the full-blown context of Mass. It can be done with communion and confession, say, you know, if the person is conscious. It can be done simply with the anointing and the oil if the priest is called to the scene of an accident. And so in the broader rite where all the conditions are right, the apostolic pardon is a regular part. It's right there. And so I think, you know, I've only seen anointing, I think, administered in my life once, visiting a friend in the hospital. It might just be more prevalent than we realize because it's not the kind of thing we, you know, we see often. But I agree that, you know, it's essentially a plenary indulgence right before you are to, you know, you're departing from this life. And what a great, you know, what a great gift that the church offers us. So I think you're right. It's not well known, but it might be more widely administered just as one component of the, you know, the longer form of the rite.
In writing this work, are you focused more on kind of popular understandings and some abused practices, or is that way of thinking articulated in like a strong theological way by a certain author that you have in mind?
I don't get too polemical. I do summarize some literature in the book, but you know there is some move theologically to decouple the sacrament from dying. The church has strongly resisted that. I think it's just a kind of false or superficial view, like applying the scientific understanding of cure to the sacrament. Oh, I feel sick, I'm going to call the priest and I'll be better. So that is, I want to correct that mentality, but I have the broader mentality. I have a chapter at the beginning on contemporary attitudes towards death. And there are a few strains. In radical atheism, for example, like the French existential philosopher Albert Camus wrote a work called The Myth of Sisyphus, in which he argues essentially that if there is no God, there's no order, there's no purpose, death is really the only thing that exercises any control over us, and therefore we should control it. That he's essentially arguing for an odd view on suicide. Mm. And so I take up attitudes, you know, towards death. In Brave New World, Huxley has a wonderful scene in a hospital where the whole hospital is set up in the futuristic year. I think it's 2350 or the year of the Brave New World, where the TV and the music and the odors are just pumped into the patient such that they don't think at all about the fact that they're dying. And I think, you know, that's closer to our culture, just total distraction.
Yeah.
And then this woman dies and her son gets all upset and the nurse is floored and says, like, you know, does he think people really matter that much? So I'm trying to, you know, help people see that how we think about death, consciously or unconsciously, is probably impacted by, you know, some of these intellectual trends, and therefore a theology of anointing of the sick that says not so much that we should want to die, because the church doesn't advocate foolhardiness, but that we should not overly cling to this life is really foreign to people.
Yeah. Excellent. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your attention.
Of course.
All right.
Grateful to be here.
Yeah, it's almost like people don't believe in the resurrection anymore or something, you know?
Right.
Well, thanks so much for joining us, and thanks especially to Dr. Nutt for your fascinating and thought-provoking presentation. Have a good evening, everyone, and safe travels home.
Thank you.